Hey, what's going on, guys? In this video, we're going to talk about the Colt Python 2nd Gen. Let's talk this out. So, without further ado, let's get right into this. I know this video is a long time coming. You know, ever since the 2nd Gen Python was released back in early 2020, a lot of people were putting in the comment section of my videos and sending me emails. Hey, the Python's back. What do you think about the Python? Did you get the Python? We want to know what you think about this Python. Throughout 2021, same deal. Everyone kept saying, hey, the Python, why aren't you talking about the Python? This and that. 2022, same deal. We are now in, April 2023 now? And let's talk about this second generation Python. Why not? I think it was when I did the court video back in February. All right, this revolver right here. A lot of people again were like, oh, the court sucks, oh, piece of junk, oh, waste of money, you should have got a old school Python, oh, you dumb mother. All the insults, all the profanity, all the weirdo whack jobs and trolls came out. But a lot of people in the court video that I did, they all said like, whoa, why didn't you get a Python? How come you don't talk about the Python? So I was like, oh, all right, we got to talk about the Python. But it's just funny how some people out there, they just get so into a tizzy about stuff that really they should not. There were a lot of people saying like, oh, why didn't you get an original Python, you dumb mother. So I do have Pythons. I originally did have a second gen 6-inch Python back in 2020. I did sell that for a pretty penny at the time because there were a few people that really wanted it for whatever reason, and hey, business is business. So I actually ended up selling that one for a pretty penny. I do have this one right here. This is the 4-inch version, second gen Python. And I do have another original, we'll call it Python, that we will probably do a video about. So we can, maybe we'll compare the old Python to this second generation Python. So a lot of people are just, for whatever reason interested in my opinion on this gun. All I can say about this second generation Python is it is a nice revolver. I mean, take a look at this thing. It's a very beautiful revolver. I like the ventilated rib look, of course. Even the Colt has the ventilated rib look right there, right? So I like that. It just looks beautiful. It's a very nice revolver. The things I don't really like about it is that the cylinder release is different. You got to pull it back and the cylinder rotates in a different way, which I'm not used to because I'm a Smith person, a Smith & Wesson guy. Those are just trivial. This revolver here is not going to be for carry use at all or field use. It's for range use only. I have a very nice holster for it, and I like to take it out to the range sometimes and just shoot it, just to have fun, you know, and let other people shoot it, what have you, and let them take a look at it, because people seem to be very interested in the Colt Python still to this day. They really like looking at it, even the second generation version. It's a fun revolver, and that's all it is to me. If it was going to be carried, well, it would have to be adjusted a little bit. But anyways, I do feel it's a good revolver. I do think it does have a very nice double action trigger roll. There's no stacking. It's almost like a sweeping motion like the Colt, but of course, it's not like this Colt's double action trigger roll at all. But it's definitely different than the Smith & Wesson. It's smooth and it's lighter. It's just different. The single action on the Colt Python is fine. It's a little bit heavier. A single action on any Smith & Wesson, like a standard old 686, probably has a better single action. But I do not shoot revolvers in single action, for the most part. I'm a double action only revolver shooter. So for me, personally, I do enjoy the double action trigger roll on the second generation Colt Python. It's pretty good. So the engineer that figured this all out, how to bring this Python back, in my opinion, did a very good job. So don't get me wrong, a lot of people were thinking I was bashing the second generation Colt Python in some of my other videos. What I was bashing was the price point, that's it. And there's some other things to bash on this revolver, but we'll get to that in a minute. The price point is $1,500. I think that's way too much for a production revolver. You know, Smith & Wesson Performance Center, I think is a better value, but you know, I'm coming around because, you know, inflation, and if you really are into this type of revolver, like you just have to have a Colt Python, then you gotta pay to play. But, you know, I think this is like a $1,200 revolver at most. Even that's kind of stretching it, but $15, I guess okay, but I would not, I repeat, I would not spend more than the MSRP out there in like auction land and your local gun shop. They should not be trying to, you know, upcharge you on this revolver. Just pay MSRP, okay? There are shops out there that are selling for like $1,300, which I think is much more fair, but it just all depends. You know, you could find for $13, but most shops are gonna try to get you at the $15, even $15.50, because they feel they can. But I wouldn't pay over MSRP at all. No, with tax and everything, no, man, it's too much. But that's my gripe, is the price point. I think it's off base, but then again, like I said, inflation. Like I said, this is an assembled gun. This isn't anything custom. This isn't anything hand fitted. However, because Colt has a union, they got to factor that in. The union worker gets paid a little, quite a bit for doing something, I guess. But it, so all that is factored in. So I leave that up to you. All right, I'll just leave that up to you. I mean, obviously, I have one right here that I'm showing you, but you know, I just wouldn't spend more than MSRP. So it is a good revolver. It's a very nice looking revolver. I think it looks cool as hell. I have one because I would like to have one in my collection. So something that comes to mind is I always think of what would Al Gunther and Alfred Dijon think of this second gen Python. Those are two people that were back in the 50s that kind of designed it or put it together, so on and so forth. I would be very curious of what the original designers would think of this second generation Python. This is a CNC machined, okay, assembled revolver, not hand fitted, like a Colt revolver, a Manuron, if we want to call MR73, you know, so on and so forth. So that's a different class. But this is a basic, you know, assembled production revolver. So the one thing I want to talk about, if you wanted to carry this Python for whatever reason, I mean, I actually carry it at the range for fun. I have a very nice holster for it, and it's just kind of cool to carry it, you know, at the range. But I would not carry this for defensive use. If you were going to carry this for defensive use, number one thing you got to do is get rid of that rear sight. So let's check it out. This rear sight here is subpar. It moves around. It's not secured at all. Look at that. Its windage and elevation, it will not stay put because it's a subpar part. I would highly recommend, I mean, I have one of these Wilson Combat rear sights. I just haven't had time to install it. It's mandatory to get that Wilson Combat rear sight on here, because with what they put on here from the factory, it doesn't stay put under 357 Magnum recoil. You can tighten it down and it might stay put for a while, but it's just going to get knocked out of zero again. So some people will ask, like, well, you got this really fine, cool revolver here. Why would you install such a subpar sight? Well, that goes to show the company, you know, I mean, when you got a company in somewhat financial trouble, you got to look for the supplier that's going to supply you with a part that's going to be inexpensive, you know, cost effective, so they don't go broke, essentially. It's just my opinion. So they pick a supplier that makes a subpar rear sight for a revolver. All right, so there you go. Will that change? I don't know. But if you're going to carry this revolver, you got to get rid of that rear sight. So that's that. I do like the red ramp front, that classic red ramp front. That's fine. I do like gold bead sights, so I might pop that out for a gold bead. But yeah, I got to put the Wilson Combat sight on here. But I don't shoot this revolver that much. So I don't know. It's still sitting in one of my drawers, the Wilson Combat rear sight. I got to put that on there. But definitely get one of those. The other thing that's interesting is, well, you all know Colt Python cylinder release, you got to pull it backwards like that. Pull it backwards and then it comes out. Very smooth. It's very nice. Ejector rod, This revolver only locks in one spot, not up on this on the ejector rod up here. Just locks on the back plate. So you got that. But it is a six shot 357 Magnum, very nice. And it rotates the wrong way, I like to say. As you can see right here, I mean, this kind of prevents a ring around the collar, the scoring around the cylinder, but I mean, if you shoot this enough, you'll see a score mark. The cylinder rotates a different direction, which kind of trips me up when I'm reloading it, like doing a tactile reload or what have you, but that's fine. That ventilated rib barrel looks awesome. You see it says Python 357. Look at that. It is kind of cool, you know? Let's see. 357 Magnum. Very nice. I like this nickel finish look. It's really cool. Target crown. All right, you get the picture. This is not a review. Full underlug. Like I said, it's not a full review. I just want to talk this out loud. Yeah, it's got the QR code there. They need that for inventory, internal inventory, so they can track, you know, where the gun is and go, you know, inventory system. And it says Colt's Manufacturing, Hartford, Connecticut, USA. That's pretty cool, I guess. The grips are, they're all right. I like them because of its classic look. But in reality, if I was going to carry this thing, yeah, I would get rid of those grips and put on some grips with some finger grooves. I don't know about nil grips on this one, but probably different type of grip on here. But I like it for the, you know, medallion right there. Just, you know, it's just a classic look. One thing I absolutely hate is the serrated trigger, because when you're rolling that back, you can feel it in your trigger finger. I don't like serrations on triggers at all. So I would smooth that out. I have it nice and smooth, just like this Colt revolver has, like that. And no, we're not going to compare a Colt to a Python. It's not apples to apples. Also, I mean, whoever assembled this buggered up that side plate screw using an electric screwdriver and over torquing it, because I don't know if you can see that. They scratched up the finish and the screw is a little bit stripped. And that's from using an electric screwdriver. I don't know why they do that, but I think everything is set. It's not that big of a deal. It's a little scratched up there. But some people will get like, oh, it's a brand new revolver. What the hell? I mean, rightfully so. It's $1,500. Come on now. So the big question is, hey, the old Python to the second gen Python, one was hand fitted. The other one is a CNC machined assembled revolver. So, you know, what's the big deal here? Well, personally for me, I do enjoy a hand-fitted gun, such as this one right here. There is a big difference. Now, CNC machining, of course, is going to be more precise with all the parts and things like that. And Colt has said that the top strap has more, you know, strength and durability there. So this revolver here is a shooter, which is very nice. Again, I don't see anything wrong with this thing, except for, like I said, the rear sight. It seems to function. I haven't had any problems with it, but then again, I haven't shot that many rounds through this specific one at all. But a CNC machining versus hand fitting. Let's talk about this. You know, someone can program the machine wrong. You know, CNC machine wrong. They could be a little bit off, and they can run that machine, and that machine will spit out, we're just going to say, 1,000 parts incorrectly. All right, that part moves on, and it's assembled by someone that really doesn't know what a gun is, nor care about it. All right, they don't really believe in what they are doing. It's just a job to them. So that's what's going on with this gun right here. Now, with something like this that's all hand-fitted, the parts, that's somebody that has to take a file to a part to trial and error to make it fit, so on and so forth. That individual is going to have expertise. All right, they're going to know what they're doing. They are considered an actual craftsman. So if you compare that, it's somebody that's going to be hand fitting something. That quality control is right there, right on the spot. With somebody that is assembling something, that quality control may or may not come, because the person that's putting that part into this gun is not into guns. Number one, they don't know what a gun is. They just know to, hey, you put part A into part B and you push it on and move it on. That's it. So somebody doing that all day may not understand that, oh, this part really isn't, you know, cut correctly, but I'm putting it in, you know, in here. Or if they do know something isn't quite right with that part, what do they care? They just put it in and they move it along. So I'm just throwing this out there. You know, most companies are going to have good quality control. Hopefully, they should catch if there's something wrong with a part. But sometimes they might not. You know, that CNC machine part might just be slightly off, and they won't find out about it until it's 2,000 parts in, and they're like, "What the heck happened here?" With something that's hand fitted, trial and error. They're getting that part correctly, done right then and there, and they understand what that part does in the gun. You know, they know they have to do it this way to make it function that way, or it's got to be this way so it can do this and that. So that's the difference between, you know, a machined CNC machine gun that's being assembled by somebody that doesn't know what a gun is to somebody that is hand fitting a gun that has a lot of pride in what they're doing. They're excited about their job. They understand all the working parts of that said firearm, and they're taking their time to ensure that everything is correct. So there's much more tighter quality control in a hand-fitted gun, and it's done by somebody that is, I would consider, an expert in craftsman. So you're talking your Wilson Combats, your Nighthawk Custom. Okay, you got Colt Revolvers, a Manuron MR73, and Gemini Custom, okay, TK Custom. These are people that know the craft, the trade. So I don't know if this makes any sense, or I'm trying to get a point out there. You know, this Python versus the old school Python, there is a difference. However, with this Python here, the machine Python, it's much more durable, it's much more reliable, and it's a shooter. Okay, so if it's done right, this is a good revolver. Once again, I want to reiterate, I don't think the second gen Python is a piece of garbage. Please, people are like putting words in my mouth. I was talking about the price point being not really appropriate. But after thinking about this for a while, you know what? Given inflation, like I said, the union worker that it demands a certain wage, okay, so be it. This it's a $1,500 revolver. I don't think it is, but so be it. It is. That's all. It is a good revolver. Like I said, the double action trigger roll is very nice. It's very smooth. There's no stacking in it, just the way I like it. So we can just quickly take a look at it. And again, I'm not trying to review this revolver here, but if we look at this, how this, it's just very smooth, but I freaking hate those damn serrations because I can feel it digging into my trigger finger. Very smooth. Single action. Yeah, it's just heavier, that's all. I mean, and then when it returns, it's a little bit more resistance too. But anyways, it's a nice revolver. I think anyone that is interested in the Colt Python, then just go for it. But please, try not to pay over MSRP, because I really think you're not getting your money's worth. All right. I want to end this video by talking about, if you are interested in buying an original Python, you really need to do your homework. So I would highly recommend try not to buy off of one of the auction sites. If you're looking for a used old school Python, I would really, really try to locate a local shop that has some used old school Pythons, because if you can, you're going to be able to take that Python and really look at that thing over with a fine tooth comb, because most old school Pythons are going to have something off about them. You know, whether it be just the finish is messed up, to, you know, the timing is off, or it has end shake, like I said, you can walk away from that. With the auction sites, you know, you're going to take delivery to it. It just sucks. You'll get it. You'll look at it. Oh no, this thing is messed up. Or you don't even notice it, and you take delivery to it. Then you realize you can't shoot the damn thing, and you lost out on $3,500 or $4,000 on this old school Python that was supposed to be, like, you know, awesome. But you know, Pythons are going for quite a bit of money. I was looking them up, and I could not believe that they are going for $3,500 to $4,500 for just a good condition old school Python. I don't know where this pricing is coming from, but man, that is very outrageous. Because some local shops, I know they're selling these old school Pythons for like $2,000, $2,200. But the auction sites, they're getting $3,500 to $4,000. Huh. I don't know about that, guys. I don't think they are worth it, because again, these old school Pythons are somewhat fragile. You don't know its history. You don't know who owned it, all those years, in the past 40 years, you know, how much, you know, how many rounds have been shot through it. No one's going to be able to help you fix that Python once you take delivery to it. I mean, there used to be a guy, Moran, that was a Python guy that could, he could just, you know, fix it, customize it, what have you. Junkin, I think that was the guy's name, Sadowski, but they're all retired, I think. So there's not many people out there, and you don't want to go to a local gunsmith and give them your old school Python and have them try to figure it out, because I know one guy that did that, and they totally freaking effed up his old school Python. His, you know, it was like a $2,800 old school Python turned into a mantelpiece. There's nothing they could do. They made it worse. And he got into a fight with them. It just, it's just, it ends very badly. So it's interesting. When you get a nice old school Python, you really have to look that thing over with a fine tooth comb and make your decision from there. You know, Colt themselves are not going to touch your old school Python. They're not going to be able to fix that Python because there's nobody there that even understands how to do anything with an old school Python. If there is, they're probably not going to risk trying to adjust your Python, you know, without, it's just difficult. So I know a lot of people say, well, I could send it back to Colt. Well, they're not going to work on it because there's no one there that can work on it. They don't have the parts anymore. That skill is gone. They have the second gen Python. It's an assembled gun. They can fix those because they're just parts that just are thrown in and out of the thing. With the old school Pythons, such as something like this, a Colt, all those parts in there are hand fitted. So if they are able to get a part, which I don't think they can really anymore, someone needs to understand, okay, I'm going to file this part a little bit off here and test it and see what we can do. We don't have any extra cylinders, so on and so forth. So you're kind of like, you're getting what you get when you're out there buying it. All right, guys, we'll continue talking about this Python possibly in another video, but I want to show you a really cool holster I have for this in the next video. I think you'll get a kick out of it. All right, guys, leave some comments below. Let me know what you think, and as always, stay safe and check 360 often. Later.